Hello, I am Renata.
And I'm Sindre.
And this is Gicare Humanum.
So, should we talk about something that we've been watching lately?
Yeah, the first thing that comes to mind is that Netflix movie we just watched about the Eurovision Song Contest.
Yeah, Eurovision Song Contest, The Story of Fire Saga. Which was originally going to be called The Saga of Fire Saga, but it didn't translate well, apparently, so they changed it.
Do you know that for sure?
Yeah, I watched some interviews and stuff.
Oh, okay. I haven't. Well, this movie is inspired by the actual Eurovision Song Contest, or you could call it kind of a spoof.
A spoof, yeah. Yeah. It's starring...
Will Ferrell?
Yeah, Will Ferrell. What's the name of the guy that I always mix him up with?
That guy in Walk Hard.
Yeah, I always think that Will Ferrell is the guy that is the main character in Walk Hard.
What's his name? Maybe we should check.
2 seconds, I'm going to check the DVD cover for that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I always mix him up with John C. Reilly.
Which is understandable.
Yeah, they're kind of the same type. And they played in a movie together recently about a spoof of Sherlock Holmes, where one of them played Sherlock Holmes and the other one played Dr. Watson.
Yeah, we haven't seen that one, but it's supposed to be very bad, so it's not really on the top of my watch list.
Yeah, I've heard that there's some good parts to it, though.
So okay.
I'm not quite sure.
Yeah, but still, it's not something... That's on top of my priority list.
Nah, me neither.
And I'm not very fond of those actors, actually. They're just... I can enjoy movies by them, but that's more like in spite of them being in them.
Yeah.
Than because of them being in it.
Yeah, well, I really like Walk Hard. And I really like...
I preferred Walk the Line.
Yeah, I haven't seen that one, but Walk Hard is very funny, I think.
Yeah, here and there. I remember the only thing that actually got me to laugh was his father singing in the barn, "The wrong kid died." That was the only time I laughed through the movie, I think.
The only time you remember, at least.
Yeah.
Yeah, but with Will Ferrell, I really like Anchorman. That's my favorite film with that actor.
Mm. My favorite is Zoolander, and he's not really the main character.
Yeah, well, yeah, Zoolander is really good too, but yeah, Anchorman is the best film he is the main character in, I think.
Yeah, because in Zoolander, I'm not really a fan of his character. What is it, Mugatu?
Oh yeah, it's the bad guy in Zoolander.
Yeah.
I had forgotten that. Yeah, that's I can remember it now. Mm.
Yeah, so he... You know, it's more like Ben Stiller and Owen Wilson's movie. Zoolander, that is. And of course, the cameo by David Bowie.
Yeah.
Which is brilliant.
And the cameo by Mulder.
Yeah, he's the hand model. Oh, that's such a funny movie.
Yeah, and it's kind of playing...
Mulder, that's David Duchovny.
Yeah, and David Duchovny in that movie, he's kind of playing a Mulder-type character there as well. He's like into the conspiracy and everything in the
yeah, that's
in the
so
fashion
funny.
World. Oh, yeah.
With all these conspiracy theories.
Yeah, but that's another comedy movie where you enjoy the film in spite of the main character, sort of. You didn't really like Ben Stiller before that movie, I remember you said.
Yeah, I wasn't very fair to him because I hadn't really watched any of his movies. But, you know, I like him now. And also I think it's kind of cool that Arthur Stiller is his father, who plays George Costanza's dad in Seinfeld.
Yeah.
Yeah, and he died recently too, so rest in peace.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. But, yeah. So that's kind of cool. I kind of see them in each other. So I don't have any beef with Ben Stiller. Yeah, no, he wasn't very likable in... he was in Curb Your Enthusiasm, where he was very douchey.
Yeah,
but,
he played himself like...
But I assume that's just kind of a joke. I don't think that's how he is, really. That he was kind of just maybe...
We haven't really talked about Curb Your Enthusiasm yet, have we?
No, maybe we should leave that for later, since we were going to talk about...
Yeah, let's talk about that more later.
Okay.
But yeah, let's continue on our sidetrack. I was thinking about Owen Wilson. He's the other guy in...
In Zoolander, yes.
Yeah. And the two of them also play together...
Yeah, in Starsky and Hutch.
Yeah, in Starsky and Hutch.
Yeah, we watched that together.
That's really good, right?
Yeah, but is Will Ferrell in that? I don't know. Maybe.
I can't remember, to be honest. I don't think he's in Starsky and Hutch. But yeah, that's another good movie with those two actors. But let's get back to Eurovision Song Contest.
Oh, God. Yeah, everything is more interesting to talk about than what we are actually going to talk about.
I disagree. I actually like this movie. I enjoy the Eurovision Song Contest movie, but you kind of was a little bit meh about it.
It was fine. I mean, my favorite part of the movie was the scenery in Húsavík in Iceland. I thought it was beautiful. I wanted to go there.
Yeah, because Will Ferrell, he plays one part of a duo band. He plays a musician from Iceland,
mm-hmm.
who is trying to take part in the Eurovision Song Contest representing Iceland. And so yeah, a lot of the movie, at least in the beginning, takes place in his home village of Húsavík, and it looks beautiful.
Yeah, and since we are from Norway too, Iceland is really kind of our neighbor, but I haven't been there, and... The scenery is, you know, it's a volcanic island, so the scenery is quite different from Norway.
Yeah, it's only sort of like our neighbor, because it's really close to us in distance and in culture and language. But you can drive or take the train and get to Sweden, and you can take a quick boat trip and get to Denmark, but you have to take the plane or take a long boat trip to get to Iceland. So it's very close by in a way, but it's much more of a hassle to get there than our other neighbors.
Yeah, and but also Great Britain. It's more common for Norwegians to go to the United Kingdom.
Yeah, it's a shorter plane ride, I think.
And
it's,
yeah, and cheaper tickets, probably.
Yeah, and it feels more...
The language is... no Norwegians talk Icelandic.
Yeah,
but even though they are close to each other, we don't understand each other.
Yeah, it's Icelandic is sort of like they speak in Iceland like they used to speak in Norway, like several hundred years ago.
Yeah, Norwegian got ruined by unions with Denmark and Sweden.
Yeah, our language got corrupted. It's the wrong word, but we got influenced by. Our proximity to Denmark and Sweden, and the fact that Norway have been under Danish rule and under Swedish rule on different occasions.
Yeah, no wonder we're always arguing with our neighbors. Friendly today, though, but...
Yeah, and that's sort of where Eurovision Song Contest comes in, because...
Yeah, nice segue.
Yeah, because all of the little countries in Europe have squabbles and beefs with each other, but we don't war anymore. We sort of just have friendly competitions, like the Song Contest.
Yeah.
Where the point of that is every country sends their own contribution. And some countries just somebody picks them, and in some countries we have a competition for who is going to be sent there. Mm-hmm. So we have a smaller song contest to decide who is going to be picked out.
Yeah, national to.
Yeah, on national TV in Norway, and everybody can vote. It's like you have to pay a little bit to send an SMS with a code for who you want to vote for. And it's like 5 kroner or something, like a small amount of money to pay to vote for one of the contestants.
Mm. And then they pick who is going to represent the country, and that person or band is sent to the international finale, which is held in the country where last year's winner came from.
Yeah, exactly. So if Norway won 1 year, then the next year the competition is going to be held in Norway. And then if Great Britain wins the next year, then the next year after that, the competition is going to be held in Great Britain.
Mm.
And a country can win several times in a year. But it's often a conspiracy that, you know, it's a lot of money to hold one of these competitions. So there's always a conspiracy that if a country wins 1 year, that they are going to send a crappy contribution the next year, so that
just to make sure that they don't have to host it several times in a row, because of the expense.
And that's actually part of the plot in this movie, because one of the bosses at the Icelandic national television, he's sure that they don't have the money to host the competition in that small Icelandic country, so he's trying to sabotage it. He actually kills some of the better contestants.
Yeah, that's maybe in spoiler territory.
Yeah, it's not really that important of a spoiler. But yeah, Will Ferrell and Rachel McAdams both play Icelandic musicians that want to take part in the Eurovision Song Contest, and their band is called Fire Saga.
Yeah, and they are probably not siblings.
Yeah, because Will Ferrell's dad in that was played by
James Bond himself, Pierce Brosnan.
Yeah.
And he's a player, apparently.
Yeah, he's apparently had relations with almost all of the women in Husavik.
Yeah, so they say they are probably not siblings, so that's like a running joke.
Yeah,
because there's a will they, won't they romance thing going on.
Specifically, Rachel McAdams is really in love with Will Ferrell's character, and he's sort of more interested in gaining recognition for his music in the Eurovision Song Contest. He really wants to, that's a childhood dream of his, to take part in that.
Mm.
And they're like not really the best musicians. They're actually good, but they're kind of goofy. And
yeah, but they go very well with the Eurovision Song Contest, because there's a certain cheesiness to the contributions, and there's a lot of glitter and glam and Europop and Eurodisco. And
yeah.
Yeah, it's a certain sound that's typical. And often you see also the winners will be someone who departs from that sound.
Yeah. Which year was it that Finland had Hard Rock Hallelujah?
Yeah, that was a heavy metal contribution that won 1 year for Finland, like you said.
What's the band?
Lordi.
Lordi, yeah. Rock and roll angels, we got Hard Rock Hallelujah. Like, up to that point, normally Eurovision contributions had been a lot of glamorous dresses, like long flowing dresses with glitter and
wind machines with poofy hair just blowing in the wind,
and a lot of that kind of thing,
and you know, choreography, dance choreography.
Yeah, like a group of dancers behind the singer dancing in unison. And very pop.
Yeah, and the competition is very, very popular among the gay community. So it's kind of got this soul pride vibe, which is fun to watch. You know, it may it's not really be fun. Something that you listen to on your own time, but yeah.
Yeah, because you're kind of more of a rock fan.
Yeah, I kind of like more rock music in general, and or more alternative music. I had a few years, you know, when I was in my teens, I was like, ugh, Eurovision Song Contest. I think even there were a few years where I didn't bother watching it.
Mm.
But now that I'm older, you know, I appreciate the goofiness of it. And, you know, you're a bit like, oh, I wonder what they've come up with this year.
Yeah.
And also maybe the more like normal and boring acts are a bit like, you know, get on with it. You want to see something wacky, but not necessarily. I was just thinking about that guy who also appeared in this Eurovision Song Contest movie. What was his name? Oh, I can't even remember what country he represented.
Yeah, the piano guy, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, because there's a lot of cameos in the movie from previous winners of Eurovision Song Contest from different countries. Even our own country, Alexander Rybak, which is, he was a guy that sang a really, how would you describe that song?
The song he won with?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it was...
I'm in love with a fairy tale. Even though it hurts, 'cause I don't care if I lose my mind,
I'm already cursed. Yeah, I think it's the song that has scored most points. Like,
ever,
it has the record. It was very catchy, and I think the thing was that he was playing his fiddle while he was singing. I mean, the song itself is very catchy, but the lyrics are very cheesy. And but you know, there was a good show, and he's a charming guy, and there were people with folk dance in the background, so it was kind of a.
That's the best contributions to Eurovision Song Contest is when the acts actually incorporate part of their country's culture into the act.
Yeah, it can be a bit cheesy, but like I said, that's part of the competition. And
which country was it that had the milkmaids that one year?
Oh God, I can't remember.
But that was like...
They were really sexualized.
Yeah, it was very... erotic milk churning,
yeah,
going on. Well, butter churning,
yeah, but like I said, that's kind of a fun part to watch the competition and go, what the hell.
And then there was, maybe that was the same year, but I think there was like some old Russian grandmas that was singing.
Yeah, did they win? No,
they were very close to winning. I don't think they won.
But yeah, that it was that party for everybody dance. I can't remember, but there were like these Russian old babushkas singing. So that
party for everybody dance.
Yeah, that was fun.
Yeah, and
oh yeah, you were looking for that. What's his name? Yeah, Salvador Sobral. Yeah, he won a few years ago.
For Portugal.
For Portugal, of course. And, you know, his song was really mellow and down, but it was really beautiful. And this song is also in the Eurovision Song Contest movie. So that was like, oh, that's that song.
I think it was actually he that was performing it in it.
Yeah, he was on the piano in the street. And, you know, that was like nothing fancy-spancy. That was just down to earth and... But I wouldn't call that like a boring contribution, because that was like a song that just made you halt and go, oh, that's really nice.
Yeah.
So that's actually a song I could listen to like on a nice summer day, I'm thinking.
Yeah, it was really nice.
But there was some controversy with him too, as he was...
He was kind of cocky when he won.
Yeah, in a way that I won because this is real, true music... And kind of implying that the others were, like, manufactured.
And he sort of had a point.
Yeah, he had a point, but it wasn't really the right platform to...
Yeah, did he say it, like, during the program?
I think he said so when he got the award.
Yeah.
So I think a lot of people kind of just stopped thinking, what?
Yeah, like, oh, yeah, I won, and all of you that didn't win was crap. You know, it's not really a nice thing to do.
Yeah, he wasn't actually saying that, but maybe
it... It came across that way. I don't think that was his intent.
No, you know, it was like... It was what he felt at the moment, maybe, but yeah.
Yeah. And speaking of previous winners of Eurovision Song Contest, ABBA is probably the most famous.
Yeah, Waterloo. And it's also an important part of the movie, because that's what gets Will Ferrell into the Eurovision Song Contest.
Yeah, he watches that in 1974 when he was a little kid.
Mm.
With the same way that a lot of us watch Eurovision Song Contest when we're children, like with the whole family gathered with snacks on the table and maybe some neighbors that has come over, like maybe it's not just that family, but...
I think a lot of people have Eurovision parties.
Yeah, it's like a huge thing, and it's very nice. And in later years, like 1 year, the two of us watched it together, and we were like playing a Lord of the Rings version of Risk.
I didn't really pay that much attention to the contest that year.
Yeah, well, but
it was on in the background.
Yeah, and that meant that the like more boring submissions, just we forgot about them, and then we paused our game when the more fun contributions got on stage, you know?
Yeah, it's not enough to put a little glitter and glam and have a boring ballad there. You need to have something more, because there are so many wacky contributions.
Yeah, that's what made Lordi so fun when they won.
Yeah, that's the heavy metal act.
Yeah, because there had been nothing like it when they won. And then they got on stage and they're full on body, like, prosthetics and stuff on them. So they look like demons. And,
yeah, I was thinking orcs when I saw it.
Yeah, like, full on masks and... a very fantasy-inspired costumes. And
yeah, and it's a catchy song too, so...
Yeah, it's amazing, the whole performance, and it was nothing like anything that had been in Eurovision up to that point, and it's just amazing.
No, so that's why they won, probably.
In 2019, last year, Norway should have won.
Yeah.
I don't think Norway should have been every year, I'm not saying that, but they were the best contribution, and they got the most votes... from audience. But nowadays, how the voting system works is that the audience has one score, and then there's also a panel of experts, in air quotes, I'm doing air quotes now, experts, that are giving their own score that wildly differs from the audience score.
Not necessarily, but last year...
Yeah.
It certainly did, so...
Yeah, I don't know which country got the most views consistently from the experts from each country, but, like, one country was set to win the whole thing, and then the audience score came in, and, like, they didn't get almost any points from the audience, so they, like, chopped down the list almost immediately.
I think, actually, the only big surprise there was Norway, actually, remembering from last year. I don't know if the other votes differed that much, but first they cast the expert votes, and Norway was, like, far down the list, and then they got the votes from the voting.
Yeah.
And, Norway just skyrocketed up on the list because they had actually gotten the most votes from the audience.
Yeah.
But because of those voting rules, then...
Yeah, and those voting rules have been changed recently. At the point where I watched most of Eurovision Song Contest, when I was like in my...
prime?
In my, yeah, it was when I was like from age 10 to 20 or maybe like that. I think most of those years, it was only audience scores.
Oh.
And then they changed it at some point to have both expert and audience score. I think it should only be audience score. I like that the best. I think that could be because that was how it was like when I was young. And
it seems more fair.
Yeah.
But still, I don't really care that much. It was just when we were watching last year, it was like, we should have won.
Yeah, and then I went on Twitter and everybody was like, yeah, Norway should have won. That's what is this? Because Norway was really fun last year. I can't remember it now even, but I'm just still angry that we didn't win.
I think it was like, it was called Spirit in the Sky, I think.
Oh, by... the spirit in the sky.
I don't think you should sing on this podcast. No, sorry. You just go ahead.
Yeah, I'm not the singer.
No, that wasn't the worst. I. Oh.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. Thank you very much.
No, but it was kind of. I think they didn't get much votes from the experts because it was kind of a dated Euro pop song, but still, it was very catchy, and they had this Sami yeah, part. They had this Sami rapper, yeah, I think.
In Norway, we have an... in Norway and Finland and Sweden, in the northern parts of this country, and a little bit into Russia as well, we have this indigenous people that is called the Sami. And I think in English they're called the Laps, because it's called Lapland. In Norwegian it's called it's the land of the Sami.
Mm.
I don't know if the whole band was Sami, but or just one singer or what it was. But
yeah, I'm not sure.
But they, at least there was some indigenous representation there, and that's, I think it's good, you know, that we have some representation from the indigenous people in Norway.
Yeah, of course. And I saw someone calling him like Sami Vin Diesel or something like that, which was yeah. kind of funny because he kind of looked like Vin Diesel.
Yeah, he kind of did.
And that wasn't a Norwegian one saying, by the way. That was like on an international Twitter thingy.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
And this year, because of the corona crisis, which we haven't mentioned up until
now. You know what?
Yeah, we actually bleeped it in episode one, but but it has been going on for so long that we can just mention it.
I think. And we all have to deal with it.
We all have to deal with it, so we can't deny that it's happening. So, yeah, the corona crisis made sure that there was no actual Eurovision Song Contest this year.
No, we had finale in Norway, and we had picked our representative.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't actually watch that, because I don't usually watch the national finale. They can pick whoever they want to.
Yeah, and then we can just watch it in the grand finale in the Eurovision Song Contest.
Yeah, that's the interesting part for me, yeah. Anyway.
In Norwegian, we actually call the contest Melody Grand Prix.
Yeah. Is that French, maybe?
Well, the Grand Prix is like...
Is that mean like big prize? Or
I'm not sure. The Grand Prix, I think when we say that, people are going to think about a car race.
Yeah, that's... But every time I say Eurovision Song Contest, I kind of have to stop because my brain first goes to Grand Prix, and then I'm thinking, no, that's not the international name.
Yeah, so we call it Melody Grand Prix. it's kind of a fun name, but I don't know why we had to choose our separate name for that.
Oh.
But let's get a little bit more into the plot of the movie.
Yeah.
We kind of covered the start of it. Will Ferrell and Rachel McAdams is in the band Fire Saga, and they're mostly like doing wedding receptions and stuff like that. And they're playing on this local pub. And one of the funniest parts of the whole movie is one of the pub patrons is yelling out all the time for them to do this other song, like this classic bar song, which they obviously made up for the movie, which is called Ya Ya Ding Dong. And it's sort of a really sexualized song that sounds innocent until you listen to the lyrics.
Yeah, but the point is that they don't get to play their own music because the audience is sort of... they just want to hear this lowbrow pub song.
Yeah, and the really funny part of that is that this bar patron, he is like really angry about it. He's like, play Ya Ya Ding Dong. And he's like really angry that they're not playing this song that is as a really silly title. And it's just so funny because he's really angry about Ya Ya Ding Dong.
Yeah, that was a bit funny.
Yeah, I laughed every time that happened.
Yeah, it was amusing. I think the movie was funny. I laughed several times. Just, it was very long though.
Yeah, it's not the perfect movie. I'm not saying it's the best movie ever. It was enjoyable.
You were expecting more jokes, you said.
Yeah, I thought it was going to be much more of a parody than it was, but it's actually more of a serious plot, and it doesn't really make that much fun of the Eurovision Song Contest. It's like,
I think it's made with love. I think that's kind of because Will Ferrell. Apparently, he's married to a Swedish woman, so he's a Eurovision Song Contest fan. So it's not really making fun of it.
Yeah.
In a way, it's more like an homage, maybe?
It's an homage with a serious core story, but it has jokes in it.
Yeah, and yeah. They do make fun. You know, they recognize that it's goofy and silly, but it's done in a loving way.
Yeah.
So I think that Eurovision Song Contest, like true fans, they will also enjoy this movie.
Yeah, and the film has a lot of songs from various contestants from the different countries, and all of them are made up for the movie.
Yeah, so, they are really good parodies too.
Yeah, they're really good parodies, and they're just good songs. Like, they're not my genre of music, really, most of them. But
they could have been in the contest.
Yeah, they could have been in the contest.
They're not that different from...
Yeah, Sweden's, like, hip-hop... hanging with the homies.
Yeah. I don't
need gin and juice, I got a cafe latte. Glaciers melting all around, but they ain't gonna drown me. And then you got Russia's really like bravado kind of big number, like something about taming lions, the lion of love or something like that. Let's get
And he's the Russian guy is actually kind of the villain of the plot.
Sort of, kind of.
Yeah, but he turns out to not be that bad, really. The only thing he kind of wants to steal Rachel McAdams because he sees her talent.
Yeah, so he's kind of like a talent poacher.
You know, he... Yeah. He kind of accepts her wishes at the end. And
yeah, and there's a whole subplot there about him actually being gay, and you can see it in his performance that he is like this poor, very butch, macho, clean-shaven backup dancers that are dancing really erotically around him, and he's singing about love and stuff, and it's very obvious that he himself is actually gay, but since he's from Russia... And in Russia, the official stance of the government there is that there are no gay people in Russia.
Which, yeah, he even says that in the movie. I think that's one of his lines.
That's, yeah.
When it's implied that he's gay.
Yeah, he's asked by Rachel McAdams, I think, are you gay? Because there's like, will they, won't they with those two characters as well. But he's like using her desire for love as a way of trying to poach her talent, you know. So he's like kind of seducing her, but then she notices he has like a kind of thing going on with one of the backstage people. And then she notices all the stuff in his act, and she asks, very respectfully asks him, are you gay? Like, because she is maybe sort of interested herself. And then he says, no, there's no gay people in Russia at all. And which is obviously bullshit, but that's the official stance of the Russian government.
Yeah, that's why the joke is in the movie, of course, because it's so ridiculous.
Yeah, and there's a lot of gay culture around the Eurovision.
Yeah, like I've already mentioned.
Yeah, and so that's there's often a discussion about if Russia should win or when they win. Like, what do they do when if Russia would hold the competition?
Yeah, and I think also a lot of people would boycott.
Yeah.
Because, you know, Eurovision, it's political as well. So I think a lot of people would boycott the Eurovision Song Contest in a country that is openly stating that being gay is wrong.
Yeah, and there's other political stuff there, for example, like the whole Israel-Palestine situation. Like, yeah. Israel has won several times. So there's a lot of issues there. I'm not going to get into it because I'm not educated on it. Yeah, and then Fire Saga submits their entry into the Eurovision Song Contest. Like, they send a demo disc of their music to the Icelandic to the Icelandic national television, and they are picked out as one of the 10 Icelandic finalists. And they do a very bad job during the televised Icelandic finals.
They weren't even gonna be in the final. but they just pulled their cassette tape out of a basket because they were missing one contestant.
Yeah, that was just on random because they needed to round it out.
But they were ecstatic and thought they got picked because they were good.
Yeah, but then they did a very bad job in the final, the Icelandic final. They felt really bad about it, so they didn't attend a boat party for all the attendants later. But that party boat ends up exploding, so all the contestants die in the explosion. So Iceland have to send Fire Saga because they are the last remaining performers that have not died.
Yeah, so they go through to the final and they're invited to this party at the Russian contestant's mansion. And all the people in the party are actually cameos by earlier Eurovision Song Contest winners.
Yeah.
Like you were talking about Norway's Alexander Rybak.
Yeah, he's there. And we don't see all of them to begin with. But then they start a big song number where they are singing some famous pop songs together, and like it goes from one person to the other, and they are like switching between who is singing, like one person is taking over from the other, and then it starts off with the actors from the movie, and then gradually they introduce actual Eurovision Song Contest winners, and then when it gets to Alexander Rybak, he is like just playing his fiddle.
Yeah, I also noticed, of course, Conchita Wurst.
Yeah, Conchita Wurst was there.
She's the woman with the beard.
Yeah.
She has a very distinct look, so it's easy to see her. And do you remember anyone else?
Yeah, it's I think, is it the winner from 2018? The Israeli woman?
Yeah, she was singing about I'm not your toy, stupid boy, or something like that.
Yeah, it's a really...
It's a very wacky...
It's a very, very wacky song, and she's kind of big.
Yeah, so she's... you remember her, at least.
Yeah, she's got a very distinct look, and her fashion is really noticeable.
Yeah, I can't remember right... I probably recognized several of them when we were watching it.
Yeah, but I don't know the names of most of them. Conchita Wurst is the most famous of them, so I remember that name, but...
Yeah, but most noticeable in our house was how our baby daughter reacted to that song number, I think.
Yeah, she wasn't watching the movie because...
I think I was breastfeeding her at the time.
Yeah, that's true. And she noticed the singing. She had been with us during the whole movie and not looking at the screen, of course. But then she, during that number, she turned around.
Yeah, looking at the screen. She wants to have a say here.
Yeah, she's telling us about how great that number was.
Yeah, because it was a lot of color and lights, and she's really into light bulbs and stuff.
Yeah, she's looking at our different light bulbs in the house all the time. And
lamps and...
Yeah, so she really liked the stage...
She seemed to be very sucked in by that song number. She was...
Yeah, and later she also noticed the stage lighting in the performances at the Eurovision final.
Yeah, because she doesn't really watch TV. She's just 3.5 months old.
Yeah, so she's way too young to watch TV, but sometimes she turns around when there's something that sounds interesting to her.
Yeah, so she gives that song number thumbs up.
Yeah.
Approved by a baby.
Yeah, so this movie was approved by a baby. But yeah, another cameo that we really liked seeing was Graham Norton.
Yeah, he's a nice guy.
Yeah, we really liked to watch his talk show.
Yeah, but everybody loves Graham.
Yeah, of course. But he is also the actual announcer on the British broadcast of the Eurovision Song Contest. Every country have their own announcer and a person who speaks during the entire broadcast and like says interesting facts about every performer.
Yeah, and they often have like funny and snarky comments as well. So
especially Graham Norton, I think you can find compilations on YouTube of his funniest bits from each year, because he always has some funny snarky thing he says about different performances. I think we've talked about this movie a lot now, and we could go more in detail about different stuff that is happening in the movie. But
if you're interested, you can watch it.
Yeah, I think basically you should watch it and make up your own mind, because I liked it quite a lot. Renate is a bit colder on it.
Well, yeah, but you know, I'm glad I watched it, and I don't think I wasted my evening watching it.
Yeah.
So it was okay. And I'm also thinking that the Eurovision Song Contest can also be a bit maybe exotic to like
non-Europeans. Yeah.
So if you just want to see, because this is like this big thing that all of Europe has in common.
Yeah, and I feel they represent the contest very well in this movie. Like you get a good view of how it actually is. And if you like it, then I'm sure you can find online some way to watch an actual Eurovision Song Contest from a previous year.
Yeah, like you said, it was cancelled this year because of the corona.
Yeah, but I'm sure at some point maybe things are back to normal next year, or at least the year after that. So
the sooner the better.
Yeah, and it is best to watch Eurovision Song Contest live.
Yeah, and the voting, and you know, it's a bit exciting and a bit of kind of patriotism that you root for your own country, but maybe you also have other favorites from other countries.
Yeah, it's kind of like the Olympics. So it's really strange that this is the first time they make a movie about basically Olympics for songs.
Yeah, it was like a really good idea out there that I was surprised that no one thought of before Will Ferrell.
And I think it's basically because most big blockbuster movies are made in America. And Eurovision Song Contest is, of course, a European thing. So I think that's the only reason that not a lot of people in Hollywood knows about this.
But I think I've heard that it's gaining popularity all over the world as because of the globalization. I think... Because we've watched a few reviews, American reviews of this movie, and we haven't heard anyone mention that it's like this weird exotic. It's like they already know about Eurovision Song Contest.
Yeah, that or some of the reviews seem to don't mention it at all, and I'm not quite sure if they know that this is not a fictional thing.
No, that's true. Because we watched someone who didn't pick up that all the party people in this mansion, that they were actually previous winners of the Eurovision Song Contest in real life.
Well, I totally understand that she didn't pick up
on
that.
Yeah, why should she know?
Yeah, because they don't actually... They don't say that in the movie. Like, you have to recognize them to understand that.
Yeah, so I think that was more like a treat for the fans or the...
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Or anyone watching the show. I wouldn't call myself a fan, but I watch it every year.
Yeah, it's just a normal thing to watch. You don't need to be a fan of it. Like, it's just...
It's like the Super Bowl.
Yeah. It's something that's... Everybody watches, not everybody, but it's so
basically
it's so common to watch it, and everybody has some opinion. And like in Norway on the radio all the time, the Norwegian submission is going on. Like after they picked the winner of the Norwegian version. So yeah, and I bet that's the same for many countries, that their pick gets played on the radio over and over in their own country.
Yeah, at least if it's selected by popular vote.
Yeah.
They know it's a popular song. I don't know if it's the same, because you got countries like this weird rules that... For instance, the United Kingdom always gets their entry in the show, in the final. They don't have to qualify, because all the other countries, they have to qualify in semi-finals.
Yeah, it's the countries that started the contest in 1956. All of those are...
They are automatically qualified for the finale. So they don't really have to prove anything. So they often send not that good contributions, maybe.
Yeah.
Sometimes they happen.
Yeah, and British people seem to not care about it anymore, because they haven't won the contest in a lot of years. So the less they win, the less they care about it, and the less they try to win, sort of.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah. I think we should move along to our homework film for this episode.
Yeah, and that's not on Netflix, unfortunately. So once again, we had to borrow it from YouTube.
Yeah.
We're not sponsored by YouTube, by the way.
We had to rent it from YouTube.
Sorry.
Yeah.
We had to rent it from YouTube.
Yeah. And yeah, the movie we are going to talk about is Parasite.
Yeah, that's the South Korean one.
Yeah.
That won all those Oscars, which made Trump a bit angry.
Yeah, well.
Which is a good thing, I guess.
Yeah, anything.
Anything to annoy him.
Yeah, it's basically, you can be pretty sure that something is good if he doesn't like it.
I think he just, he's probably not seen it. He just probably didn't like that it was
A foreign movie. Yeah.
Yeah, they removed the classification foreign movie from the Oscars.
Oh.
I think it's called like international movie now.
That makes more sense because it's only foreign from an American standpoint.
Yeah. And
like it's not foreign from a South Korean standpoint.
No, of course. And you know, it's like I said, with more and more globalization and the world being one.
Yeah, but then international gets into the same problem because what? So American movies are not international. Only movies not from America is international.
But still, it is an American award ceremony.
I've heard. I don't know which person. Oh yeah, I think actually the director of this movie has been quoted as saying, yeah, the Oscars are actually just a local awards ceremony.
Yeah, he's right about that. It probably have won some other big awards too, like the one in Cannes, Gold Palm.
I know which one you're talking about. Yeah.
But isn't it like the first international movie to win Best Picture, I think?
I think so, maybe. But it's well-deserved, I think.
It's a very good movie.
Yeah, it's a thriller comedy.
Yeah, dark comedy, I have to say.
Yeah.
It's been very hyped, but it's deserved. I can't really think of anyone deserving it more.
So, the movie was directed by South Korean director Bong Joon-ho. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly, but probably close enough, I'm going to hope.
Yeah, I will remember that name now. I watched several of his movies before, and I kind of just thought they were like random Korean movies. I didn't realize it was the same director.
I'm a bit ashamed to say. we watched a lot of his movies together, and because they were on Netflix, and they just looked interesting.
Even before I met you, I watched The Host. Not knowing it was his movie. That was just because it was like a South Korean monster movie, so it sounded interesting.
I haven't seen that one yet.
No, maybe you should.
Yeah, well, let's...
I don't remember a lot from it, really, but, you know.
A few movies of his that we have seen together are Snowpiercer. I really like that one. That one is also, I think it seems most of his movies are about class struggle in some way.
Yeah.
And Snowpiercer, that's a science fiction thing with Captain America in the main role. Like, what's his real name?
His name is...
Chris Evans, I think.
Yeah, sure. I just blacked out.
Yeah, so Chris...
I was thinking Hemsworth, but that's not him.
There's too many Chrises.
Yeah.
But Chris Evans plays a poor guy living in this Snowpiercer train. And the train is like... symbolic for the world and the different classes in it. Like, the poorest people are at the back of the train. And then as you move forward, in the front are the most wealthy people.
And then there was Okja, if I pronounce it correctly.
Probably.
Maybe. Which I think was about some big animals that were specially bred for food.
Yeah, the whole movie is an allegory for the meat industry.
Yeah, because this animal in particular is living with a girl, a young girl, and they form a special bond.
Yeah, it's been genetically made in a lab. Like, this is the perfect animal for consumption.
Mm.
But it's also an animal still.
And it's intelligent, and it's more like a big dog.
Yeah, and this and they have placed several of these animals out with like rural families in different places in the world. And the idea is to show that this can be used anywhere in the world, but it is actually a marketing ploy to give the business that makes these a good image. When, we see later in the film, the actual places that where most of these animals are going to be kept are like really horrible conditions.
Mm.
And it's like a really horror show. And that mirrors how in real life, a lot of really big slaughterhouses and stuff treat their animals. It's like, I don't think the movie is like completely against meat consumption. It's more against how we treat the animals that we are going to eat.
It's a good movie. I like that one.
Yeah.
And Parasite, of course.
Yeah.
Which we just saw.
Parasite is really good. It's billed as a thriller comedy. It starts off on a comedy note and gets more into thriller as the movie progresses.
Yeah, but it's got a serious undertone. Because, it's about classes and it's about the Kim family who are poor and they are living in pretty much a basement with just some tiny windows up on the wall where their view is like rubbish bins and people peeing. And And also their income is that they're folding cardboard boxes for a pizza delivery place.
Yeah.
So I'm sure they don't really make a lot of money, but their situation is about to change.
Yeah, at some point, the son in the family, there's the father, the mother, the daughter, and the son in the Kim family. And the son in the family gets a job covering for one of his friends as a
tutor.
Yeah, English tutor for the daughter of a rich family, the Park family.
Mm.
And that family also has a father, a mother, a daughter who he is going to tutor, and a very young son.
Mm.
So those two families mirror each other in the family members, but they are vastly different. But yeah, the main plot starts off in the first half of the movie. It's about how the son of the poor family systematically just tries to replace all of the help in the rich family's household with his own family members.
Well, not just him. They, as they get into the household, they all participate in replacing the... Because the rich family, they have a driver and they have a housekeeper.
Yeah.
So
So first he gets a job for his sister and he presents of that.
They pretend to not know each other.
Yeah. And he gets a job for his sister to be a art therapy person, like psychologist kind of for the young son.
It's just bogus too. And I actually think he's like a normal boy, but they think he's like weird because he's acting really like a child.
Yeah.
But they think there's something wrong with him.
Yeah. And then the sister, the daughter in the poor family, she gets the driver fired by leaving her underwear in the back of the car. And when Mr. Park, the father in the rich family, finds it, he is disgusted. And so he fires the driver because he thinks that he's been using their car for sex.
And then she, or they...
Yeah, and then they recommend the father...
They kind of sneak him in so it's not too obvious.
Yeah.
And he gets the job as the driver, the father.
The father in the...
Kim family.
In the Kim family. So the poor father is driving around the rich father.
Yeah, and he used to be a driver too, so he actually pretty much knows his job.
Yeah, and then they also get the housekeeper fired and then get the poor mother a job as the new housekeeper.
Yeah, so they get their entire family...
embedded in the...
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's at least one reading of the film, is that poor family is parasites of the rich family.
Yeah, in a way, but, you know, they are actually working too, so...
Yeah, no, it's like...
It doesn't really fit the definition.
That's the first reading you can get, and there's another reading you can get later on, which is more accurate.
Mm.
Much later in the film, and this is where a big plot twist comes in. So if anything of this sounded interesting, then turn off the podcast and go and watch the movie. And then you can come back to us and listen to the rest of this.
Are you suggesting that they haven't done their homework?
No. That's not something that I'd ever do, like listen to stuff about things that I haven't seen.
No, of course not.
Yeah. Well, here's the big twist coming in. At one point, the Park family goes camping, and the poor mom is supposed to be left and caring for the house, but since the Park family is out, all of the Kim family stays in the house and takes
use of... Get drunk.
Yeah, and have fun with the Park's family luxury.
Yeah, but nothing too fancy. They're just sitting around in the living room talking, I guess, and drinking beer.
Yeah, and drinking wasp water.
Yeah.
Wasp water is Norwegian water that anyone in Norway can just get in the sink. And some company has taken and bottled a bunch of it and goes around selling it all over the globe to way too much when we get it for free.
To be fair, we actually sell it here as well, and people buy it because it's a cool bottle, I guess.
Yeah, it's so dumb, and I think that was chosen deliberately.
I think for a while maybe it had won something like the purest bottled water in the world or something, and I think Madonna was drinking it, so it's probably gained global popularity maybe because of that.
Yeah, like Norwegian water does taste good, much better than the tap water we had in our hotel in New York when we went there some years ago.
I didn't drink that.
Yeah, because why would you? But but still, they are selling water. And okay, tapping it and the bottles and transporting it all over the world, there has to be some cost to that. But it's just so overpriced, the water. It's still just water and it's being sold. And this is...
Isn't there something, an expression about selling sand in the Sahara or something like that?
Yeah.
That's accurate for Norway at least, because there's a lot of water here.
But that makes me think of a new phrase that I came up with just now, selling water in the Sahara, which is way worse. Like selling sand in Sahara, then maybe, okay, it's up to the person that buys it. But water is necessary to live.
Yeah.
So if you start selling basic necessities to way overpriced prices, that's pretty bad in my opinion.
Yeah, but like this expensive water, I think you have like cheaper alternatives. So maybe the reason why the Park family, they have a lot of bottles in their fridge.
Yeah, it's just filled with wasp water.
Yeah, so it's just probably part of their... They're very rich, so it's part of their image, I guess, to buy the high-end label of water. Imported, you know.
Yeah, but water generally is a big theme in the movie. There's a lot of water imagery.
Yeah.
The rain scenes is going to be very important later. I'm not sure if we're going to get into that, but...
Yeah, we can't go into too much detail, I guess, because there's a lot of imagery in this movie. So I guess the reason we picked up on the water, I guess, is because it's, you know, a Norwegian brand of water.
And Voss is a location in Norway, but that's not where the Voss water comes from.
I don't know why they picked that.
I've heard that they just looked at the name where it actually came from, and I didn't like the sound of it, and they looked at the map and, oh, Voss, that sounds
better. Yeah, Voss is something everyone can pronounce, I guess.
Yeah, so it's the marketing fakery.
Yeah, anywho.
Yeah, and while the Kim family is all staying at the house, it starts raining, but then the old housekeeper that they replaced, she comes to the door and she said that she had left something.
Yeah, down in the basement. So she asked if she could come in.
Yeah, and they let her, probably feeling a bit guilty about getting her fired. But then she goes down into the basement and starts pushing at this big commode or something.
It's like a floor-to-ceiling shelf.
Yeah, it slides open and there's a hidden stairway behind it.
Hmm.
And then they start going down it and it starts getting really creepy. And then they find a starving man down there. Because it turns out she had been hiding her husband in the wall there. And he had been stuck there for so long after she had been fired. And he hadn't been able to get any food because the door had been... Like the hidden door out had been stuck. That's a weird twist, right? We didn't expect something like that to happen.
No, but you kind of need a twist in a movie like this, maybe. I don't know. I don't know where it would have gone if they just...
Well, the film seemed to go along the route that they were going to replace the household staff and...
Even the family, the rich family.
Yeah, that's something that they joked about at some point. So that could have been where the plot was going, that... Oh, yeah, no, they have replaced the household staff, and no, maybe they're going to, like, scam their way into their money and their house.
Mm.
So that seems like maybe it's where the plot is going, but then suddenly it twists around, and, oh, yeah, there's a person living hidden in the house that the Park family doesn't know about.
Yeah, because... They bought their house from an architect?
Yeah, from an architect. So he had been building, like, secret compartments and stuff. Maybe just for the fun of it, I don't know.
It's weird you didn't use that as a selling point when you were selling it.
Yeah.
As a kid, I always wanted to have, like, hidden rooms in the house. And I wish we had, like, a hidden room behind the bookshelf. That was, like, kind of my childhood... dream.
I think actually he had been living there before the Park family bought the house.
And yeah, I think so.
Yeah, I think the housekeeper followed the house. Like, she was the housekeeper for the previous owners.
Yeah, and that was why she knew about the secret door.
Yeah, but when the Kim family finds out about this, that they have been hiding there, at first they are going to expose them.
So the previous housekeeper is pleading with them to not expose them. And she's appealing to their sense of class, I guess. Like, they're from the same class.
Yeah.
But I think, in a way, the Kim family sees themselves as above them. Because at least they have a window in their apartment. While these people are living totally underground.
Yeah, and by the way, the husband of the previous housekeeper, he is probably the titular parasite. Because he's, like, living in the walls of the family that is actually living in the house.
Mm. But then they somehow reveal themselves.
They expose themselves for being fakes, the Kim family.
Yeah, they talk and the previous housekeeper films them.
Yeah, so then she has proof that they are actually exploiting the Park family, kind of. And so she can get them fired and maybe, like, imprisoned or whatever. So then they have each other in a stalemate, sort of.
Mm. And also, while the rain is raging, the Park family has cancelled the trip.
Yeah, so suddenly they are coming home, and now they have to, like, clean up the entire apartment, and the mother has to make, like, some sort of dish that I don't remember the name of, something with beef and stuff.
Oh, I was just thinking that we picked up on the extravagant water they were drinking.
Yeah.
But I also read that this dish that they wanted the housekeeper to make, that's sort of a cheap comfort food. But the kind of meat they put in is like a really exquisite kind of expensive meat.
Yeah, so
I didn't pick up on that, but it's probably more well known in...
So it's basically like making pizza with gourmet steak.
Yeah, which you can do sometimes. I think we are guilty of something like that.
Yeah, well, but it's an allegory, sort of.
Yeah, but they have, like, really short time before they're back. It's not like we'll be back in 2 hours. It's like more 15 minutes.
Or something. So it's like it's a rush. The Kim family has to deal with the previous housekeeper and the parasites. Like, they have to hide them and sort of fight them over this mobile footage.
Mm.
All while they are also cleaning up all the stuff they left around while they were drinking and stuff. And the mother of the Kim family has to cook this dish. And it's like a kind of funny high-speed slapstick sort of thing that where they are running from room to room and fighting the two other people and everything like that.
Yeah, and since the housekeeper is actually the only one who's supposed to be in the house, they don't have the time to run outside, so they have to hide under the living room table.
But before that happens, they chain the parasite down in his basement, and then while they are fighting his wife, the previous housekeeper, they kick her down the stairs, like the hidden stairs. And she hits her head and starts dying.
Yeah.
So that's like, it's just this whole slapstick scene. And even the kick is presented in a funny way. But then you see the outcome of it, and it's like horrible.
Mm.
So this is pretty much where it completely turns from a comedy into the thriller. That kick is the point where it switches.
Yeah, I was kind of secretly hoping that they would join forces in a way.
Yeah, like they should, because they are in a shitty situation together. Like they are both poor.
Yeah.
Both those families.
But because they see themselves as better than the basement stowaways.
Then, yeah.
that doesn't happen.
Yeah. But yeah, then the Park family is back home, and most of the Kim family is hiding under a table, and then they have to sneak out after the Park family falls asleep.
Yeah, and to cut it short, when they get back home to their basement, the sewer system has been flooded, so there's sewage everywhere.
Yeah, and it's not just for them, it's like their whole neighborhood is like trying to rescue each of their stuff out from their apartments.
Yeah, so you get the contrast with the Parks. They're kind of just sitting in their safe home going, oh, look at the weather. And
yeah, oh, it was so nice to have rain. And then you get to the Kim family.
They're losing everything.
Yeah, they're losing everything they have and have to swim through shit.
Mm.
And yeah, we can't bring it justice how annoyed you get with the Park family at this point, because they're like so smug. And it's not like they're not cruel. They don't know about this, but it's just, you get so angry at them for saying, oh, it's just so nice with rain and being so content with life, when, like, there's people that lost everything because of that.
Yeah, but like we were saying, that's because it's played as a contrast in the movie. But in real life, you know, you probably would have felt the same if you're safe and you don't know anything about other people's struggle because of the same thing. You'd probably be like, oh, that's a shame with the rain. It's like that here as well, because it's raining a lot here, but maybe some other place people are losing their homes because of stone masses falling down from the mountains.
Yeah, well, that's a different thing, because those stone masses, that's part of nature, while the Kim family are actually living in apartments that were not supposed to be livable even. Like, this is something we saw in some video or something at some point. This is like, only poor people live there, and it's not actually habitable for people. It shouldn't be people living in those basement apartments.
No.
So that is a direct result of more well-to-do people not helping sufficiently the less well-to-do people. So it's people like the Park family, not them specifically, but people in a similar position as the Park family, that resulted in people from the Kim family actually living in the conditions they are living in, which resulted in them being flooded with toilet water.
Yeah, and the Parks family's big worry during this rainstorm is that their son is staying outside in their back garden in a little tent. But, you know, he can just come inside anytime he likes to.
Yeah. So, yeah, again, like, these are not evil people or anything, but it just, the contrast makes you sort of hate them in a way.
Yeah, but even the Kim family, they say, like, they are nice. And I think the mother answers something like, yeah, it's easy to be nice when you're rich or something like
that. They can afford to be nice.
Yeah. So they're not painted as crooks. So I kind of like that. It's not just black and white.
Yeah, it's not like, oh, the poor swindlers are evil or the rich people are evil. Like, they're just people, all of them. But yeah, they're in different positions. And yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, but the end of the movie, that's actually when I kind of felt a bit more appalled by them. You know, because they have this birthday party for their kid.
Yeah, the youngest.
The youngest boy of the Park family. And they have this garden party in the back garden with all of their friends. Yeah, and also there's a moment there when the son in the Kim family, the poor one, is looking down. He's standing up in the daughter's bedroom and is looking down, and he kind of realizes that he's never going to be a part of that society.
Yeah.
Even though, you know, he hasn't revealed to the daughter that he's actually poor, I guess.
Yeah.
But he is her boyfriend in a way, I guess.
Yeah, she's basically like, has started a relationship with her English instructor.
Yeah, and she kind of says that he'll fit in.
Yeah, she thinks that he will fit in, but he knows that he will not.
And never will.
Yeah, and because of that, the son in the Kim family, he goes down to the basement to reconcile with the parasite man. He has a name, I can't remember it, I'm sorry. Yeah, but he's going to reconcile with the guy who they killed his wife. So what actually happens is that the parasite breaks loose and kills him.
No, he doesn't kill him. He winds up in a hospital. He survives.
Yeah, that's true. Okay, yeah.
You don't know if he survives. Yeah,
he tries to kill him. He takes this rock, which is kind of important, but let's not get into it.
Yeah, let's not get into that rock now.
But yeah, after the parasite, after he knocks the poor son's skull in with a rock, he takes a kitchen knife and he comes out to the garden party and he stabs the daughter of the Kim family.
Yeah, and she dies.
Yeah, she dies.
That's the annoying part that, yeah.
Yeah, she could have been saved.
Yeah, she's bleeding out on their lawn.
But the rich family's young son, he gets a shock from seeing this guy because he's seen him in the house before when he was sneaking around at night.
Yeah, and then he thought it was a ghost.
Yeah, so he gets a shock and like faints.
And they are commanding their driver, who is also the father of this girl who is bleeding out on the front lawn. They are commanding him to drive them to the hospital with their son, who's just like...
Yeah, and I don't care about the girl that has been stabbed at all, because she is like...
She's help.
Yeah, it's not as important that she is stabbed and is bleeding out as it is important that their son has had a shock and fainted.
Yeah.
And then they're trying to get the Kim father to come and drive them to the hospital and leave. And they don't know that he is the father of this woman that has been stabbed, of course, but still.
Yeah, but still, it's someone bleeding out in your garden.
Yeah. There's a few other stuff that happens, and...
Yeah, it's a dramatic scene. I think the housekeeper, or the mother of this woman, she turns the parasite basically into a human shish kebab. She takes...
I can't remember that, but...
she took one of those spears that you use for barbecuing.
Okay, nice.
If I remember correctly. It's weird that you don't remember it, so
yeah,
I'm thinking maybe it happened in my head.
No, I remember it now that you say it.
Okay.
Yeah.
But there's a whole lot of drama, and of course the father...
Yeah, the father ends up killing, like the poor father ends up killing the rich father.
Yeah, so he has to flee.
Yeah, basically it's like getting really angry about the class disparity, I think.
Oh, I think it's because even in this chaos, in this state, the father of the rich family, he's kind of, he holds his nose because he thinks they smell.
Yeah, because they are living in a moldy basement and there's a poor people smell on them.
Yeah, and especially when the father previously in the movie is driving the father around, he's like kind of like, what is that smell? And the smell is kind of brought up several times.
And they hear him, the poor family hears the rich father complaining about it when they are hiding under the table.
Yeah.
So then they hear like how they are talking about them when they are not there.
Yeah. And then even as this catastrophe is happening,
yeah,
then even then he can't look past the poor people's smell. So that's like the final straw for the father in the Kim family.
Yeah.
So he kills him and he has to flee.
Yeah. He sneaks away and we learn later that he has taken the parasite's place. Like he is the new parasite.
Yeah. He has moved back into the Park family's basement. So he's living there now and he only sneaks out at night, I guess, stealing food from their fridge.
Yeah.
And then goes back. The light bulb that the so-called parasite used to send Morse code messages to the father of the house to tell him thank you.
Yeah.
This time around, the father of the Kim's family is using it to signal to the outside world where he's at, because his family doesn't know that he has survived and that he is still hiding in the basement. And not just the family, but also, you know, he has killed a man, so he's wanted.
Yeah.
And the son in the Kim family, he actually Does he learn Morse code for this?
Yeah, I can't remember if he knew it already or if he saw that it was Morse code. I think maybe he knew it already.
Okay, but either way, he finds out that his father is signaling him from the inside of the house. And his plan to get him out is just to become rich and buy the house.
And yeah, that is probably not going to happen. It's very difficult to move up in society from being poor to being rich. And he'd have to be pretty rich to afford that home. We haven't talked about how the home looks, actually. It's a pretty cool design, right?
Yeah, it's modern house. I don't know, like minimalistic. I don't know how else to explain it. I read that the song in the end credits is called 546, and that is a reference to how many years the son would have to work in order to afford that house.
Oh.
Because I think the director had calculated how much he would work. So that kind of gives you the answer that no, he won't be able to afford the house ever. No matter how much he works. And
yeah, so he will never free his father from being a parasite.
Not unless he has a better plan. But yeah, because you can see the ending also of the movie as a bit ambiguous, because there's like this dream sequence where you actually see the son buying back the house, and you know, he's got a wife. They go to the house and they free their father. In this sequence, he buys the house back and he releases his dad and everything is fine. And, you know, the director, he could have just ended the movie there, and then you could kind of interpret, did this really happen or was it just fantasy? But then it cuts back to him sitting down in that horrible basement where the family lives.
Which is flooded with, like, shit water.
Yeah. Is he looking at some school applications or something, or is...
I think he looks at the camera.
Okay.
Like, yeah, this isn't going to happen.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe he realized it was a crazy dream that wasn't to be. Anyway, it ends on a bleak note. And also, I guess if you understand Korean, maybe there's more in this song about how this is never going to happen. You know, I read it later on, the meaning of it.
I feel that quite a bit was lost in translation for... We had a Norwegian text on, and I saw the trailers for an American audience with the English text on.
Mm-hmm.
And there was like several things that were more poetically written, sort of. Because I think maybe it was pretty directly translated from Korean to Norwegian.
You assume the English translation was better?
Maybe. I'm not sure, but I'm betting there was a bigger focus on it.
Hmm. Yeah, I don't know. You know, it's people translating, so it's...
It's fallible either way. Yeah.
Errare humanum est.
Yeah, well, yeah. Our podcast title is probably not perfect Latin.
No.
So that's enough for this episode, I think. I'm really happy with the movie. I think it deserves its recognition.
Yeah, even talking about it makes me appreciate it more, strangely enough.
Yeah, and I'm looking forward to watching more movies from this director, older ones that I haven't seen, and the next one he will make.
Does he have anyone announced? Do you know that?
He's apparently credited as a writer on the Snowpiercer TV series. I'm not sure if that's good. I haven't heard anything, really.
No, maybe we'll watch it. Maybe we won't. Time will tell.
Yeah, but it's your turn to choose a movie for us to watch next episode.
Yeah, and for new listeners, these are movies that we have in our collection that we haven't shown the other person.
Except this one. We're going to sometimes go away from that formula when there's a movie we really want to be watching, like Parasite.
Yeah.
So what's your pick?
Well, that's a difficult question. Now I was thinking about, you know, you have like a gaming backlog.
I have a series on my blog where I try to play all the games on my gaming backlog, and I write a little bit on each of them. I'll post a link in the show notes for anyone who's interested in that.
Yeah, so I was just thinking about finishing up things. And I just remembered that we've been watching a trilogy together where we haven't watched the third movie, or you haven't watched the third movie.
Oh, which... I'm not sure which one this is.
This is The Godfather 3.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
So I'm going to give you a chance to finish the trilogy. Even though it's not considered to be as good as their first movies, of course. But, you know, you kind of should watch the entire thing, I think.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing it and finding out if I actually agree with that, that it's not as good as the previous one. Because I actually think that I liked The Godfather 1 more than 2, and most people like 2 more than 1.
Mm.
And maybe I should rewatch all of them, kind of, because... Maybe I'm wrong on this. Maybe the second one is better.
Yeah, I don't know. I like them both. But the third one, I agree it's not as good, but I think it's worth seeing at least.
Yeah. So for anyone who hasn't seen that one, or maybe hasn't seen any of the Godfather movies, now you know what to do before the next episode.
Yeah. So that's it for today.
Yeah. Thanks for listening, everybody. We'll see you next time.
Bye.
Bye.